Today's bookmark is brought to you by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation.
You and your household has decided to participate in our trial. Halloween is our favorite holiday. There are so many little lab rats running around. We are excited to present children with the greatest Halloween candy of all. Survival. That's right. We've got the juice, baby. We've worked long and hard, several weeks, on this experimental vaccine, and we are super excited about it. Now you're saying, maybe the children get a little nervous. Kids don't like needles. Well, that's true. Just like there are tricks to get children to eat their vegetables, there are tricks to get them to be responsible citizens. I'm gonna show you one right now. So look at this. It's a bowl of candy. Is it? Or is it the end of COVID? That's right, kids. Just put your little paws in there and grab all you can. Bill and Melinda are so excited about the future that they couldn't be here today. They're in an undisclosed location preparing to go to space. But they have left you in good hands. Here at the Gates Foundation, we realize that some of you are so excited about the future, we're gonna have to put you in restraints. But we'll do that for you.
So happy Halloween. Welcome to Bookmark.
Yeah, welcome to Bookmark. I hope you enjoyed that long introduction. I guess that was our Halloween introduction.
Yeah, well, this is the Day of the Dead edition of Bookmark.
Right.
And this is our weekly podcast where we talk about the week's events and other things in general going on in the world.
Right. Yeah, we like to insert a little bit of humor and dialogue and lightheartedness in our weekly podcast. We try. It's kind of hard in the age of COVID.
Yeah.
Things are getting serious out there in the world. If you're really paying attention, things are getting serious. Mm-hmm. So, you know, what we're also doing is we're creating video essays, and the video essays are, we like to think of it as archiving history and explaining to you in a creative way what's really going on behind the scenes, behind the election shenanigans and behind the COVID-19 shenanigans and everything involved with the things that are right out in front of you and sort of, you know, attacking you from the media at all ends all the time. There's more stuff that's going on behind the scenes. That's the stuff you really want to pay attention to. And that's what we're doing, is we're bringing that to the front and we're shedding a light on those things. Creatively, we use music and visuals to do that. We write our own scripts, mm-hmm. you know.
So. And we're going to drop a new video sometime this week and for our patrons. So to segue into that, mm-hmm. we are in the middle of our fall fundraiser. So you could be a patron and see the videos first before anybody else.
We're looking for, we need about 5 or 6 new patrons mm-hmm. For the month of November.
Yes.
So for as little as $2 a month, you can help help keep the lights on. This is how we earn a living.
Right.
So it would be really great if you could share our YouTube videos, watch them, and share our YouTube video essays, mm-hmm. the ones that are scripted with the music and the images.
Right.
What you're looking at now is Bookmark, which is our weekly podcast.
Right. And so we fit in our commentary in between our larger format, long format video essays. So like I said, we're going to drop one this week, and it's available first to patrons. So you can go to patreon.com/bookofhours, and I'll put the address up there. And you can contribute as little as $2 a month, all the way up to whatever it is. I think we have it $50 if you want. Mm-hmm. That would be awesome, but you don't have to. We're not asking for too much from each person. what you feel comfortable with. If you like the content that we make, we do appreciate you becoming a patron. But if you can't do that, you can make one-time donations to paypal.me/bookofhours. Or, like I said, we have our fall fundraiser going on. So that's on Facebook. You can go to facebook.com/bookofhours and scroll down to find the fall fundraiser screen, and you can contribute there. So there's a number of ways that you can contribute to us, help us continue doing the thing that we do, creating the content that you enjoy. And so we'd really appreciate that. We do need some help. Because otherwise, Julie is gonna have to become a test rat for for the COVID. You got something in the mail?
I got an email that said that, because of who I am, I could qualify for up to, a certain amount of money if I would go through, basically be a lab rat for the COVID-19 vaccine. So I really don't want to do that.
So help Julie not have to do that.
I really don't want to do that.
But it would mean a lot money-wise to help us, but we don't want her doing that. I don't want you doing that. I like the way like you the way you are. I don't want you getting changed.
You don't want a Julie 2.0?
No, not at all. So please help Julie not be a lab rat.
Yeah, and, that would be great.
Contribute today.
I know. What? I got the short straw, right?
You did. Or it was, I thought it was rock, paper, scissors.
Oh, right.
We want to say thank you to some people who've contributed. Actually, one person, Colleen Virgilio, thank you. She made a donation on PayPal. So there's, like
on
I said,
Sunday, there, she
on
made
Sunday,
the
yeah.
Donation.
So
thank you.
And we do appreciate that. We have other people that are making contributions. Some of them like to be unnamed, so we'll leave it at that.
Right. But I think the best way to support our work is to share our videos.
Right.
We have received some wonderful shout outs from other content creators and smaller content creators like Church Dog 42, who gave us some really nice shout out recently.
Yeah, you did. You picked up some new followers on Twitter, right?
Picked up some new followers on Twitter as a result of that, and probably picked up a few new subscribers on YouTube because of that. Mm-hmm. And that kind of stuff really helps. I'd like to just interject a comment about that. We really need to look out for those who don't have the bigger reach. I mean, there are content creators out there that are considered an alternative to mainstream press or mainstream opinions, and they are taking up the entire.
They suck the air out of the room.
They really do, and it makes it really difficult for those of us who provide really excellent analysis of what's going on. Some of the analysis is done, in a very sort of casual way, like in a person's, kitchen or in a person's, second room in their apartment. For us, we create video essays where we create, the level of analysis and the level of creativity that goes into it comes from, our corporate and professional and design and writing and marketing backgrounds. So we're taking all of that stuff that we learned in our corporate jobs that we had in the past, and we're applying it now to our video essays. So we feel that our work should be front and center, to some of the other more popular podcasters out there, like the really popular ones who don't really do anything.
Yeah, there's some that just read news, and there's others that do work hard.
We actually, work at it.
Well,
and hours a day to create these video essays.
Yeah. Now, granted, there's some people that we follow or used to watch a lot more, and they do put a lot of work into theirs, but, they also have, tons of followers, too, and they've been,
hundreds of thousands of followers.
Yeah.
Like, we're always told, why don't you have hundreds of thousands of followers? And there's a couple of different things going on there. First of all, we're kind of new to the scene, and second is, like we said, these larger podcasters, like these really, really big ones, and they're usually the really big podcasters that are the alternative to mainstream press. They are sort of the reactionary types, and so what they're doing is they're hitting your emotional buttons, and so when your emotional buttons are pushed, you become addicted to the drama. It's like, you know, being in a really cool relationship with somebody who's always got a lot of exciting, dramatic things going on in their life. And, you know, JP and I, we're not reactionary types. We're not reactive types. We're not very dramatic. We're, you know, extremely honest and very transparent. There's really nothing exciting here that we freak out about. We don't really lose our cool. So maybe that's what we're doing wrong. we're not getting excited enough for
Chicken Little
for you guys and Chicken Little-y and ooh, the sky is falling. But I just, that's not really us. Yeah.
And something else is, you know, Julie keeps saying, you know, we're not the news, we're artists. And we report on things going on in the world from our perspective rather than like trying to pretend that we're newscasters or we're news people. But we do analyze events and culture through the lens of an intuitive means and putting things together that other people don't. And we get comments all the time where people say, wow, I would have never thought of that before.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, and we base, you know, we're not just making stuff up. We base it on things that we read and we put things together and correlate things that a lot of people don't. So, you know, that's what people like about our work. And
I noticed that in, at least with Americans, I noticed that the commentary is often, oh, we love artists, we want to support the arts, but you don't really, you know, you don't really. What you want to do is support people that, you know, this is just maybe the whole human experience, is what you want to do is support people that mirror your own belief systems. And if the art makes you uncomfortable, or if the art rubs you the wrong way, or if the art doesn't exactly meet your political position, you're not going to support it. And, you know, we've all been there and we've all done that. So we're very honest, you know, about our perspective. Our bottom line about this entire experience is that COVID-19 is a marketing campaign. And it is a cover. It is basically taken out of a 2003 badly written script from a very poorly executed TV show called The Dead Zone, you know, and it's the exact same script for that, and it's the exact same script for every other schlock.
Down to the fact that it was a coronavirus, right?
Yeah, and it was even a coronavirus. Down to the, and also, you know, it's been taken from every other schlocky, badly made, ridiculous, non-creative TV show or movie. I mean, this is all predictive programming come to life. That's all it is. It's a marketing campaign. Mm-hmm. And it's a little irritating when people are like, oh my God, you know, wear your mask and all that. It's just, it's getting irritating. It's a marketing campaign, and you're destroying your autonomy and your sovereignty, and you're mutilating yourself by putting on a mask. Because of some really slick and well-funded poster designs. That's mm-hmm. why you're doing it, mm-hmm. because some poster designs, you know.
Yeah.
So I just, it's getting to the point now where it's like, this is who we are, this is what we believe. If you want to support that and give that a stronger voice, then you'll support us. Mm-hmm. I mean, we take ideas from our patrons and create video essays out of them. We've done it twice now so far.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you know.
Great. Well, Julie, Saturday was Halloween.
Yeah.
You found some photos of some interesting Halloween costumes out
right.
there.
Right. Not in our neighborhood.
In our neighborhood.
We decided to not give candy away or do anything. We did lifelong learning. That was our gift to the children.
Okay.
Basically, lifelong learning is our 50-minute video essay that explains that the children are being programmed to be obedient, and they're not in school, and they're not really learning anything. There's really no access to real education. It's obedience training. Obedience training for slavery. So there you go, kids. You can put that in your little candy basket or in your little candy bucket, and you can get yourself the hell out of school, because right now you're being trained to be a slave. So that was our gift to the kids, so we didn't think we needed to give them candy or open the door to them. Besides, there weren't that many anyway. We decided to just, you know, do our own thing. We watched cartoons and had our own candy and
right.
had some wine and whiskey.
Basically.
But yeah, we did come across some photos online that I thought were really
Let's have a look.
Funny.
So yeah, so so clearly there's a theme going on, and you would have in San Francisco every year there used to be a foot race called the Beta Breakers, and it was always full of, like, you know, 90% of it were people in costumes walking the route, not running it.
It really was just an excuse to party with your friends,
and
dress up like an idiot,
and do, you know, like teams, and they choose themes. I'm sure that Corona would have been a theme this year.
So, for people who don't understand, Bay to Breakers, so it was a marathon. I'm not sure.
It wasn't even a marathon. Oh, it was like maybe,
like
it was.
It was a run.
Like 5 miles. It's not that long. It's just that you've got to go over hills and stuff.
Right.
And
so it goes. So San Francisco is a city that's 3/4 surrounded by water.
It's a peninsula.
Right. Yeah. So the city is 3/4 surrounded by water, which means the bay is where the bay is, like under the bridges, it's the bay. And then on the other side of the city is the ocean, or where the waves break.
Mm-hmm.
That's why it's called Bay to Breakers.
Right.
It's referring to you're running from the bay, which is usually in the, like in any port city, it's like in a downtown area. And then you're running across the city to the ocean where the waves break. So yeah, those photos of the Halloween trick-or-treaters and, you know, the various Halloween costumes were really, really sad, but funny.
Yeah.
You know.
So speaking of sad and not funny, and not really Halloween related, is we've been getting reports from Paris and Europe. So Paris is going into lockdown, as has London,
all of England
and Ireland. We reported last week that Wales is under lockdown, so all of England is now under lockdown. Boris Johnson came out and you know did this speech.
So did Macron.
And so Macron did too. But here we have some footage of Paris people trying to leave the city before the lockdown and quarantine goes into effect.
Thank you.
So what other information have you been hearing?
Well, it's been, you know, it's kind of understood that if you're in France, you know, that you have to prove that you have a right to be outside. So from what I understand, and this is why there are 8,000 troops deployed onto the streets. You know, Churchdog 42 does a much better analysis of this, but from the UK Independent article that I read and from various other tweets that I've read, the general idea is that you have to show kind of, it's kind of like a show your papers situation where you have to have your, you have to have something from your employer to show that you have a right to be traveling from your home to your work. So if one of those 8,000 troops stops you and says, why are you outside? You have to have a good reason. You have to have proof of that. Like, you're taking your kid to school and the school has written something that says, my child attends the school. Or you have to have, you know, some kind of employee badge to show that you are mm-hmm. an employer, or you have to have some, or, you know, an employee, or if you have like a doctor's appointment, obviously you would need, you know, some kind of email from your doctor confirming mm-hmm. your appointment. So, you know, that's not freedom. That's right. Not living in a democracy. It's nobody's business what you're doing.
Right. You know, and Paris hasn't seen this since the 1940s when right. the Germans marched in.
So this is basically the equivalent of the Nazi takeover of Paris and the 1940s, like he just said, which is when the Nazi party was requiring people to show proof of why they were walking around and doing their things, yeah. you know, and whatever, living yeah. their life.
So, I guess, I don't know, it's not as severe in London, but it sounds pretty bad.
It's, you know, and so I guess what, you know, so JP and I are trying to, you know, find like-minded people in the Pittsburgh area. He put up a post on a group called Reopen PA or Mask Free PA, and we received hundreds of responses to those posts, and not one of those responses was from Pittsburgh, except for maybe three people. One person said, I would love to, you know, get together over coffee or something and talk about, you know, what's going on and how crazy it is, but I'm just going to wait for things to go back to normal, you know, because they're going to go back to normal after the election. And I looked at this email from this woman and I was like, wow, you really don't know what's going on. Like, we're never going back
yeah,
to normal.
Yeah,
never happening.
Right. And so, we'll get into the election in a minute, but I think, you know, a lot of people think that the election is going to change things, and it's, yeah. it's really sad.
So I guess what I'm trying to say is, you know, we need to look at what's happening. This is something that we've been saying since March 13th, which is when, you know, Trump decided to upend the United States as you know it and hand it over to FEMA and big business. Mm-hmm. So, you know, Constitution erased, ripped up, thrown into the garbage, bye-bye, if you believe in that kind of stuff. I believe in sovereignty, individual rights. I don't need a piece of paper to tell me I'm free. But, so on March 13th, when I think it took him about 30 seconds, where he said, you know, it's been a good run, it's been great, thanks a lot, you know, it worked for some people, doesn't work for others, see ya, wouldn't want to be ya, kind of thing. It took him 30 or 40 seconds to upend almost 300 years of American sovereignty and democracy. So,
yeah,
good job. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that it's never going back to normal. You can't go back to normal because there is no back to anything.
Right.
You know,
right.
It's over.
Yeah.
It's over. It ended on March 13th.
Right. So, and then, you know, when things are seem to be getting, you know, even more strict, we have reports from Governor Cuomo, that...
So that, again, was a headline I read, which I didn't get a chance to read the whole article.
So have a look at that. We don't have a lot of information on that, but just that they're limiting entry into the state of New York by means of if you can prove that you have a negative test,
right,
or a negative, you know, results on a COVID test, you're allowed
right
in.
Right. So, look, we know that these kinds of measures, like all of the lockdowns all over the world and this whole business of like, well, you can't come in if you've ever been tested positive for COVID or la la la, whatever. None of this is really about, you know, keeping the curve down or keeping the right cases down or whatever. It's a rollout for more surveillance. They need everybody inside so they can start, you know, throwing up, you know, maybe 5G towers in the poor communities so people's heads can explode, I guess. I don't know. But the point is that they're going to do these surveillance streets. I mean, we're seeing it all over Pittsburgh anyway. Pittsburgh, which looks like basically a bombed out third world country with, you know, buildings that are falling apart, they're putting a lot of money and a lot of energy into widening the roads for bike lanes, which is great. We like to ride bicycles. It keeps us healthy. But we know that the Slow Streets Initiative, for instance, is part of the Sustainable Development Goals. And sustainable development is all about track and surveillance. Mm-hmm. They need, you know, they were doing it in San Francisco too,
right,
like on Market Street, when they had the cyclists go by. And then there was this one tracker that said how many cyclists had ridden on Market Street, and it would go up to like 100,000 or whatever.
Right.
And everybody was like high-fiving. Why? That was a way to track you
right
and surveil you without your permission. So it's good to ride your bike, sure, but riding a bike should mean freedom. It should not be used as a way to incentivize your further oppression.
Right.
Okay?
So the Slow Streets Initiative, this is part of like the where they're closing streets off to cars, so that pedestrians and cyclists can ride, and pedestrians can socially distance and walk around each other in the street. You know, it's all bullshit. Also,
that's
the whole thing,
right?
Also, the whole thing with putting the what they call in San Francisco anyway, they call them parklets, and these are extensions from the sidewalk that go into the street where restaurants are, so that people can sit outside in the street on a platform as opposed to being inside the restaurant.
So back a few years ago, years and years and years ago, San Francisco was one of the first cities, and probably Seattle, to institute these really awesome measures, okay? And the reason that they did these parklets were because these are two heavily touristed cities, and they were getting a lot of complaints from like the tourism department that said tourists were frustrated because they were coming and they were walking up and down these big steep city streets, and there was no place to sit. There were no benches to sit on to enjoy your cup of coffee. They wanted to sit outside, so they created something called parklets. Parklets are like an extension of the sidewalk kind of into the street, always really well built, beautiful benches, lots of plants.
Architecture
around.
Firms would always like design them.
Yeah,
right?
Very so designery, very lovely, lovely places. But now that we're in the age of COVID, JP and I go back to those days years and years ago when we used to love to sit and enjoy being in a parklet. We realized that is getting people used to sitting in extensions of the restaurants and the cafes and the cool little bars or wine bars or cocktail bars that you always would love to go inside. You're not going to be able to go inside to those places anymore. So the idea of a parklet was to integrate you into getting used to the idea of having a lovely dining, fine dining experience where you throw down $100 for your anniversary dinner or $150 with your friends for a nice dinner, but you're outside under a tent. That's what the parklets were for. They were to get you used
right
to what we're seeing now in the age of COVID.
And we've seen those parklets in Pittsburgh and in other cities as well.
Oh yeah, there's like a couple
you know,
in Pittsburgh.
So,
and they're, you know, they're really cute. There's always like plants everywhere.
Right.
There's lovely seating.
Right.
You know.
But, you know, now it's changing. And then we've seen some more dystopic ones in other parts of the country.
Yeah.
Like those ones that we saw in Huntington Beach or in Orange County. those were kind of icky.
Yeah.
You know, because the streets weren't that nice, you know.
Right.
And it's like, why they have to do that there. Or they were into parking lots, too. They were like, you know, like these sort of strip mall type restaurants, you know, and the seating goes out into the parking lot.
I know, you're like trying to eat your pasta and breathing in gas fumes.
Right.
That's a lovely experience for, you know, all the money you spend.
Right, so. Exactly. So
I guess the point that I want to go back to this idea of having, you know, in-person, you know, real experiences. We were looking for like-minded people, and we would, you know, maybe make a dinner. JP and I are amazing cooks. We've learned, you know, we really upped our game in the age of COVID because, we upped our game when we moved to Pittsburgh because, like I say before, even before COVID, it's like a bombed out third world country. There's like no real, except for maybe one or two places, there's no like good food here. So we can cook, you know, we're like, why would we go out to eat when we know that the food would be, the food would not be as good as what we can make? So so I thought, well, this would be really cool to have people over and cook for them, and we could have like a dining experience, you know, inside in our home, which is kind of like a cool, crazy studio and, you know, art studio. Inside of an old house. It's like kind of cool, you know, we wanted to do that. So hopefully we'll be able to, we've got like two people, I think. people that are interested. So, you know, it's exciting.
Yeah.
But, you know, back to, you know, what's going on this week. With Barcelona, Sweden.
Yeah. So here's the protest video of the week. That was Barcelona. They're getting serious out there.
Well, I mean, to be honest, I think that someone just emailed us some footage of more protests in Berlin or in Munich.
Okay.
Okay, so what we have are European cities: Berlin, Munich, Barcelona, Paris, London, we've got these, Toronto, we've got people outside of the United States that are basically saying, you know, that are defying the COVID lockdown restrictions. They're defying COVID orders, so to speak, you know, and I'm sure that there are even more countries that are coming out as well. We just haven't seen them yet, haven't seen the footage of that.
Yeah, okay. Well, you know, yeah. And those, a lot of those, like the Toronto protests have been recurring, as well as London. There's been calls. I saw a tweet from Winter Oak wanting people to come out for Guy Fawkes to protest. And, you know, despite the lockdowns that are taking place. So, bully for them, that's good. I'm glad they're doing that. Meanwhile, in Sweden,
Sweden.
So Dancing Queen, having fun in Sweden.
They're having fun, but it's starting to feel kind of like, it's starting to feel a little disingenuous. The Sweden feeds that are coming through, it's starting to turn into something kind of malicious.
Well, and it feels like it could be propaganda too.
It does. I mean, first of all, Sweden did exactly what we did. We murdered the elderly, and they also murdered their elderly. So that's number one. And then they, you know, they probably have all sorts of, well, isn't Greta Thunberg, isn't she, Greta Thunberg?
Greta Thunberg.
It's actually, well, I mean, if you really care, it's Greta Thunberg. That's how you pronounce her name. But anyway, it's Greta Thunberg, and isn't she from Sweden?
Yeah.
Like, okay. So, obviously, they're going to roll out green sustainable development goals in Sweden. And all this stuff is implemented, so they don't really need to force their citizens inside, because all this stuff has been, you know, rolling out for a long time prior to COVID anyway. I don't know so much about, like, chipping the Swedes or the vaccine for the Swedes. I don't think that's so much their deal. I think it's more about sustainable development goals.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Which is an Orwellian term for surveillance.
Right. Well, and also the human capital markets too.
Right.
You know, so it's not just about watching us. It's not strictly about
You have to understand that when I say surveillance.
Yeah, the surveillance goes hand in hand with human capital markets and being. They have to keep an eye on us because we are the capital. We are their means for making money. So.
Right.
These things are all being rolled out because of money. If you want to know, if you're ever confused by what's going on, just remember that it's all about the billionaires making money from us.
Right.
On the backs of us.
That's
we
really
are the source of income now.
Think of, like, somebody who is, like, you know, a peeping Tom. You know, they're looking at you through their binoculars inside your window. And you finally confront them and you say, okay, so you're watching me. Why are you watching me? He always wants something. He wants something from you. He wants to see when you're leaving so he can go in and steal your jewelry. Or he wants to, you know, see what your patterns are so he can follow you to the bank and rob you. Like, people don't just look for the sake of looking. They always want something out of it. Whether it's some kind of, you know, some kind of pleasure, you know, or they want something from you. So when I say it's all about surveillance, sustainable development goals are really all about surveillance, it's understood that it's to extract something from you. I mean, I thought that was clear all along because
people don't understand that.
Been kind of our thing from the very beginning,
but
even before COVID.
But, you know, we're always seeing people talking and they don't understand that this is all about money.
Yeah, it's all about money.
It's all about money. Right, so
where's
this is,
the money?
You know, people are like, oh, it's a communist takeover. And it's not a communist takeover. It is purely capitalistic. The capitalists, the billionaire ruling class, the oligarch class,
are
looking to extract money from us. And they're doing this through a number of means. And go back to our videos, go back to lifelong learning, and go back to other videos and watch, like, you know, The Great Reset. And you will see that the money is all, you know, this is what this is all about. COVID is a marketing campaign to keep us in place, to keep us down, to keep us confused. And fighting with each other.
I'm not confused.
Fighting each other so that we aren't paying attention to what they are doing. And
right.
You know, you said 5G. I think 5G doesn't have much to do with it except for it's the means to allow them.
Did I say 5G? Oh, yeah, I said 5G.
Yeah, yeah.
I was kind of joking.
It's the means to allow them to connect their surveillance equipment.
Right.
Everyone, I hear other people like, oh, 5G, 5G, 5G. Look, 5G isn't as advanced as people think it is. I have not seen any evidence of it going in around the different cities. Now, it might be, I don't know. But the thing is it requires a lot of hardware. And I have a feeling that the lockdowns are continuing and keep coming up because they're trying to find a way to connect all the surveillance without that, because they know that this 5G is a terrible technology that's hard to implement and expensive at that.
And it would cost too much. So the whole point of these, you know, corporate, so going back to this idea, sorry, I'm gonna interrupt myself. Mm-hmm. Going back to this idea that it's communist and Marxism and all this. All right, the companies that are in San Francisco that are working with the Fourth Industrial Revolution, which is running out of a very nice park.
It's a nice building in the Presidio of San Francisco.
Right. The companies that are working with them, they are like dudes in hoodies, writing code. They're not communists. If you have to give them a label, maybe neoliberal, maybe libertarians, I don't know. They're just there to make their, you know, $250,000 a year and their increasing bonus based on your information that you put into your social media and your media accounts. Like, they're not Marxists. They're like They're not leftists. They're not anything. They're just running a business. They're running an app, and they're just like,
right. And these app companies, especially the ones that are considered the unicorns, that they don't have any means of real income. They're being supported through capital investment. Venture capitalism that's coming from the government.
Yeah.
If you ask yourself, like, how does Twitter make money? Twitter took over a huge building in downtown San Francisco, this beautiful old Art Deco building. And, you got to wonder, like, how is it they make their money? Well, it's certainly not from, they don't have ads. Well, I guess they have ads now, but what I'm trying to say is ad income isn't going to
give them the kind of money that they make.
Right.
The ad revenue that they put on your Twitter feed or your Facebook feed isn't enough
There's something else going on there.
It has to do with military and government funding and since when is DARPA Marxist? I mean, come on.
Right.
So, all right.
So, election is tomorrow.
is it tomorrow? Oh, yeah, it's tomorrow. And so tomorrow. Is our anniversary.
Yeah, we've married 3 years.
Yay.
So, yeah.
High five.
Oh.
See, we're in sync. Now give me a high five.
All right.
Boom. We made it. 3 years.
So 3 years, and unfortunately, we spent most of that here in Pittsburgh.
I know, right?
Anyway, so tomorrow is the election. We are of the opinion, and you know this if you've been watching, that we do not support you going out and voting. In fact, we say vote no confidence by not voting and walking away. Okay?
Right.
It only encourages them if you keep voting for them. So, just stop it.
There's this girl that we know. She was in San Francisco, and now she lives in Portland with her... She probably has a couple of kids by now, and her husband and whatever. And she goes onto Facebook today, or Sunday. She goes onto Facebook Sunday, November 1st. And says, if you probably have noticed, I haven't been on social media that much. I have really been keeping a distance from social media. And because every time I log on, it's just nothing but ads. It's ads. And it's just not, Facebook, Twitter, whatever, social media is not the experience that I'm used to. But I did want to come on to tell you to vote because it's the most important vote of your life.
It's an important thing to do right now.
And I'm like, how many times have we heard that over the years?
We hear that every 4 years. And it's
always
total
life
bullshit because, go to our latest video, Deconstruction, where we discuss what's going on, why it doesn't matter if you vote. The stance we take is that the governors are going to go away because of the way that the world is being restructured in terms of governance. We're looking at a future of global governance, and it's organized by global, regional, and local. Maybe a few things in between, but that's primarily how it's going to be organized. And so governors are going to go away, and we feel that the office of the president is going to go away too, because national identity and national countries are going to go away and turn into larger regions, and that's just the way it is.
Right.
Or smaller, broken up regions. So we talk about interstate compacts. So several states get together and are now forming policy and laws and rules and regulations through the means of these compacts for the entire region rather than for specific states. Yeah, I know. Well, we made it exciting.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah.
Deconstruction was really, really good. So I would say that...
If you haven't seen it, there's strippers in there and there's lots of money floating around. No, I'm kidding.
No. So I would say, I would even go so far as to say that when you engage in the electoral process, you are engaging in further oppression for yourself, for your children, for your children's future. Let me just put it to you this way. after decades and decades of voting, whoever you are in your life, I don't know how old you are and how many years you've voted, you are now at a point in this country, in the United States, where your child will never be able to afford to leave your side. They'll never be able to branch out and get their own, like, home.
Well,
that American dream, that American, you know, concept of hard work and bootstrapping it is gone. Mm-hmm. Okay.
If it was ever real in the first place.
So I hope you like your kids, because they're never going to be able to afford to leave you unless you're of the managerial class. And the managerial class are the ones that are implementing fascism. All of these sustainable development models that are being rolled out and cudgeling out our autonomy and sovereignty and freedom, whatever. Okay, so unless you're of that class and you're heading a nonprofit, or you're a founder of an app, or you're something else, then your kids might have an opportunity to have a normal life. But if you're not of that class, your kids are never going to be able to afford to leave your house.
I feel like, what we're going to be seeing is what people have been talking about, where, people are going to be pushed into larger cities.
Right.
But, living
whole
in very, very small spaces.
Pushed into smaller spaces.
Yeah.
I guess what I'm trying to say is, after all these years of voting, your kids don't have a future, you won't have a pension, you're being forced to mutilate yourself by wearing a mask. Lockdowns are coming for the United States. Just pay attention to what's happening in Europe and you can see that we're next. All of your freedom and autonomy and sovereignty has gone away. All of your small businesses in your neighborhoods have gone away. Your streets aren't getting fixed. Your water is poisoned. Food is difficult to come by. Everything is outrageously expensive. It's terribly expensive to buy a home or to buy a car. And so what did voting get you after all of these years? Here we are in 2020, and this is what we're facing. Mm-hmm. Self-mutilation, forced self-isolation, coercion, fascism, a seizure of your government by unseen, unelected committee members that are run by corporations which don't have your interest at heart. The only thing that they're interested in is extracting from you until you're dead, forcing your kids not to have a future. I can see that your vote all these years and all the energy you've put into it, I can see that it's really
paid off
for you.
So now we have a Lady Gaga video.
Hey, this is Lady Gaga. I'm voting for America, which means I'm voting for Joe Biden. And if you live in Minnesota, Pennsylvania, Georgia, Michigan, Florida, or Arizona, I encourage you to vote. And if you have a friend that lives there, tell them to vote. I'm going to be in one of these states tomorrow. Guess which one I'll be in? Hint, I used to live there. Cheers to the 2020 election.
Okay, now that video, pissed both of us off, but here's the thing with that video, and I'll let you speak in a second.
Oh my God, I'm wearing fatigues, too.
Yeah, you're wearing fatigues, too. So I'll let you talk about this in a second, but one of the things we've been talking about is how this election is going to be a repeat of the 2000 election. We've been talking about this, right? Mm-hmm. How the Democrats are going to throw a shit fit, and they've already said this, the press and the media and the Democrats and the liberals, they're all going to throw a shit fit if Trump is reelected, and we're not going to see a president right away. The results are going to be held up because there's going to be protests and there's going to be all kinds of shit that goes down as a result of that, if that happens. I was talking to Julie about that video specifically, sort of the semiotics, the signs and symbols that are going on. So, yeah, Julie commented, she was wearing fatigues next to a big, a big 4x4 truck, and she opens a can of something. We assume it's beer. We don't know.
I thought it was a bottle of water. I don't know.
Whatever it was, she was, and then the Lady Gaga boots, Mm-hmm. But, so clearly she was, like, taunting Trump voters and people who live in what she would consider flyover country, even though she called all the states out that are swing states by name. She said she's going to, grace us with her presence in these locations sometime soon. I'll make sure I miss that. But so she's basically taunting and making fun of the people who vote for Trump. And so this is, you know,
this is really antagonistic.
It's very antagonistic. Yeah, that's a good word. And it's very telling of the attitude that liberals have and the attitude of, like, what's going to take place. Because as Julie pointed out to me, and I didn't pick up on this at first, was she took the can and threw it down. Right? Yeah, throw it on the ground. That's it. You know, it's like, you know, you better vote for Biden.
You know, right? Trump wins again. And everyone's going to throw a shit fit and have a huge shepherd day. Well, the point is that we've already had social media come out and say, oh, well, we're going to, you know, fuck over all of your social media feeds if he wins.
Right.
They've already said that they're going to throw their temper tantrum.
Right.
They've already said that they're going to contest if he legitimately wins or not, or if he's legitimately installed or not. They're still going to throw a temper tantrum. So no matter what, you get your temper tantrum, right? So ready, liberals, to throw a shit fit.
And to the conservatives out there, you know, Trump is not going to change anything.
Oh, no.
He's on board with...
He's like, vaccine, warp speed.
Warp speed vaccines. And he's also all about stakeholder capitalism, which is a new form of capitalism, which means that, you know, it's not what you think capitalism is. It's far beyond that, and it's going
to
be
about... It basically means you get to be poor for the rest
of your life. We're going to equal out
So
everybody
poverty.
Gets to be equally poor.
Yep.
That's what they mean when they say equity and, you know, equality and...
You know, at this point, it's like if people don't get it, if they haven't figured it out yet, it's...
You know, it's the feel-good corporate language that's coming from Davos and the other global governance, you know... People who support global governments.
Yeah. You know, these people that are you know, making financial decisions in your communities, these people that are, you know, basically just doing the equivalent of dropping a bomb on your small businesses and closing down hospitals and rearranging things and telling you that, you know, you don't need to be treated for cancer. You can be treated for COVID.
Yeah.
You know, those people are people that their feet never touch the ground. They live on airplanes, they live in villas and beautifully, you know, beautiful mansions by the sea. They have many multiple homes. They have big meetings and giant, you know, boardrooms with sweeping views of the Alps. They don't...
Well, maybe the city, but yeah.
or whatever, okay? You don't factor into any of this. You don't factor into any of this. I don't factor into any of it. And yet you think that those people whose feet never touch the ground...
Have your best interest.
Have your best interest at heart? Are you kidding me? Like...
Yeah.
Where's the disconnect? Like, is it an American thing? I don't know.
No, this is global, too.
Yeah, I know. But why are people in other countries getting it? It's like, oh, yeah, maybe rich people actually want to hurt us.
Well, they've been protesting Macron for a while, but, you know, they're still, you know, these people's...
Yeah.
They, you know, the Macrons and the Boris Johnsons, they still, you know, do what they want, right?
Yeah.
And it's not because they have power, it's because, you know, there's something else going on. And, you know, that's what's going on. That's why voting doesn't matter.
No, it doesn't.
Because they are just playing fealty to
whoever's controlling
them.
It's really wasted energy. It really is. It's total wasted energy. It's just a waste.
And
energy.
We're quickly going into the system of serfdom and royalty, right?
Right. Maybe people don't even know what that means. So you get to live in dog shit while all of the oligarchs get to live, you know, the very few oligarchs get to live in big castles.
So,
if you're lucky, you can clean up their poop.
Right.
If you're lucky.
Right. So if you've ever just read up on feudalism, it took place after the Roman Empire and before the Renaissance.
We're literally living in neo-feudalism now.
So we're in it now, and it's going to get worse.
Yeah,
right?
it's really bad.
Yeah.
It's really bad.
So speaking of all that, some gross pop propaganda to keep you distracted and going forward. Ugh. Let's go surfing.
Okay, where's my vomit bucket?
Put So this was like some nuns, some sisters that are dancing to, there's that woman again, Lady Gaga. She's
Lady
in the back.
Gag?
Yeah, right? you can see some of the sisters in the foreground kind of going, you know, they're the older ones and they're kind of going, well, this is fun. And the younger ones are like, yeah. And then, you know, you've got them with cameras. Now, I think they're real. I don't think they're the fake.
Yeah, they had lanyards on. Yeah, it was like a special event. Yeah. Maybe like the Pope was like, absolutely fun. I don't know.
It was Lady a conference. Gaga. It was a conference
You're
of sisters.
Catholic, right?
Okay, right. Sure. It was a conference because you had different orders. You could tell by their habits.
He grew up Catholic. So, I did not.
Yeah, so you'll see they have different outfits. Okay. They're called habits. And each order has its own way of dressing.
Oh, my only experience with the nun is the flying. Nun, oh. Watching it on TV.
Well, they were a different nun. They were a different order as well. So, yeah, I was taught by Dominicans. They were pretty, you know, plain. But anyway, so that was the dancing nuns.
That was now, really funny.
It was weird, though.
It was weird and a little off-putting, but also kind of funny.
Yeah, it was
like,
kind of funny.
Kind of funny in a really scary way.
Yeah, but like, you know, it's
perfect for our Halloween.
It's kind of reminiscent though of like the dancing doctors and things like that. But I think it was real.
Oh yeah.
I don't think it was a fake one.
You know? This one's real. Those are real nuns.
Speaking of
okay,
fake,
now I need my gag bucket.
Here's a fake video because it takes tropes from other videos that you've or other ideas that you've seen in the past where you know the father is coming home from Iraq or from Afghanistan or wherever
military
the U.S. is. Wherever the U.S. is waging war these days, and returns home, and the kids are so excited, and okay, let's watch it.
There's not a plumber coming. There's someone outside who you've been wanting to hug for a very long time.
Oh, I know who it is.
So put our masks on. Really important not to take them off, okay?
Okay. Well, we're going to hug them.
Let's go. Let Isla come first. Make sure your masks are on, please. Pull your masks up. Go on.
Isla, no, don't run.
Okay, so yeah, let me vomit in my mouth, please, because that's just too much. The bunny suits on the kids and the masking. Like, make sure your mask is on. Now it's British, so you know. Yeah, I mean, they're just as in. You know, they're just as in many wars as we are. I mean, they just basically.
Oh sure, they're all fucking over people.
And. It was gross. I mean, the mom's like, make sure your mask is up. Make sure. And it's
so stupid.
And Julie pointed out how they weren't able to run.
Right. They couldn't run. They're like.
Because they've got these bunny suits on.
Stupid. Well, see, I'm the same way. When I have a mask on, I can barely walk. Yeah. I'm like, because my sense of balance goes way off. So I'm all. Oh, bumping into people at the grocery store. Oh, excuse me!
Right. Well, all their sensory input is taken away except for sight, right? I mean, they can barely hear, they can barely touch.
Right.
They can barely.
That's the whole point.
You know, that's the whole point, right? And it was just, it was really gross. That was just, and just the whole idea of like, this is your future, folks. This is your future. This is never going to end.
And
like, what the fuck are you wearing bunny suits for? Why are you in these?
Well, okay, so let's look at it from, I'm going to look at it from the media perspective as well. So if you recall,
that was rhetorical, by the way.
What?
Yeah, that question. What the fuck are you wearing bunny suits for?
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, go on.
Well, if you go back to like the 70s and then the 80s and then the 90s and then the 2000s and then now, like this kind of bullshit trope has been going on in commercials forever. So, you know, I'm old enough to remember the 1970s or 1980s holiday Folgers coffee commercials where the big brother comes home from college and it's, oh, the big brother's coming home from college. And, you know, the parents are asleep in bed and the little sister is asleep in bed and they wake up to the smell of coffee and they're like, oh, Billy's home from college. Okay, so you've got somebody coming home.
He learned how to make coffee. That's cool.
No. It's the emotional bullshit. And then in the 90s, it was the phone commercial.
Right.
Oh, remember when they talked?
Remember the long distance
when they talked to somebody on the phone.
Right.
You know, it's the same thing. It's always somebody coming home and connecting with somebody else. Mm-hmm. And then in the 2000s, we were like, yeah, let's amp up, you know, our one or two countries that we're bombing and extend it out to seven. It was always some idiotic military person. Oh, look who's coming home, you know, and it went from commercials to your social media account. And now dad is coming home from being quarantined because of COVID on your social media. So this can't, what's next? Somebody's going to be, you know, coming home from outer space. And it's going to be the same bullshit where you're going to knock on the door from, you know, Uncle so-and-so who's just traveled to Mars and is coming home to,
he's been on a penal colony on Mars or the moon.
Right, exactly. So it's like this emotionally manipulative, triggering trope that has literally been going on since like the 1950s. Yeah, they're not very smart.
No.
They don't come
up
with
creative.
Any original ideas. They're not creative about this kind of stuff.
No.
It's just exchange the 1970s, you know, Folgers crystal or Folgers coffee commercial during the holidays with the kid coming home from school during the holidays. Exchange that with COVID-19. It's the same exact storyline. Mm-hmm. And as a creative and as somebody who's in marketing and someone who enjoys writing and doing and reading and watching, you know, creative things, I would like to see something different. If you're going to shove bullshit down my throat, at least make it interesting. Don't keep repeating the same tropes over and over again.
Yeah.
It's you know, you're going to lose your
audience. Well, that's, you know, it works. That's why we call it propaganda. You know, it works and people buy it.
Yeah.
They get into it and they forget what, you know, or it's the kind of thing where it's like there's, you know, you're so programmed into it, you're so locked into that idea, you know, and it's that sentimentality that people respond to.
I hate sentimentality.
Well, that's what sells, you know, and that's how they're selling this whole thing. They're either selling it through sentimentality or the threat of, you know, and I'm using that literally, the threat of, you know, you're not fitting in because you're not, you know, getting with the program and you're not being kind and thinking about the common good, right? So it's either a cudgel or it's like, you know, syrup, you know. Mm-hmm. it's really pretty gross, and you know, on either way we're being inundated and sold a bill of goods.
Yeah. It's boring, it's stupid.
So, yeah, well, speaking of propaganda, now it's time to give a pitch again for Book of Hours. please, do go to our Facebook page, facebook.com/Book of Hours, to maybe contribute to our fall fundraiser. We do need your cash. We do need your help financially to keep the lights on, to keep things going. I will make a pitch also. What I'd like to do, or we've been asked to put our Bookmark podcast into audio form, and I would like to make them available on a platform that's really accessible, like SoundCloud. Well, SoundCloud is going to cost us around $144 a year. That's $12 a month. So I'm looking for a sponsor, okay? Would you like to pony up and, you know, put that money out there, and we can, you know, mention you in the next 12 months? In all our audio podcasts. So, you know, if you want to contribute to that and say that that's what this is for, that would be great. You can go to paypal.me/bookofhours, or you can go to patreon.com and become a monthly patron, or you can go to Facebook. there's, you know, many different ways that you can support us. And so these are some of the programs, some of the things that we need to do. We'd like to keep Bookmark going. We'd like to keep our essays going. So, you know, and we do have, you know, everyday bills, but we also have bills that are related to creating this content.
Yeah, we do.
So please give what you can, and we'd appreciate it very much.
Right. Judith, one of our patrons, we met with her, and she pitched an idea to us and said, can you make this into a video essay? I think this would be a really good way to inform people about, you know, what's going on in the world, in this certain, subject matter, mm-hmm. Which is co-ops and worker-owned cooperatives. So that's another thing that our patrons do, is they give us ideas and we create video essays mm-hmm. out of them.
Yeah. Yeah, so mm-hmm. so you can, as Julie likes to say, join the team,
right.
Become a patron,
and be
and
part of the team.
Be part of the team, and yeah. you know, we'll take your ideas and turn them into something.
Right.
Sorry.
Okay, so we are going to end with somebody that we really have come to really enjoy her work.
Yeah, our friend Kevin sent her video our way.
Right, he actually texted me yesterday or the day before, and I was blown away by this lovely young woman. She lives in Australia, and you know, there's a lot of suffering going on, and she's turning her suffering into her music, and I hope you get something out of it.
Yeah, this is Vanessa Valentine, and we're going to close with her song. So, I guess that's it for now. We'll see you next week on Bookmark.
Thanks.
Thank you.
I wanna walk outside past 9. I wanna play live music and feel alive, but your silence is deafening. Their presence is threatening. So say something. Say something. And people call me brave for speaking out and speaking up. It's not that I am brave, it's just that I don't give a fuck. Why should I care about the things that I say? I won't stay silent, I won't be quiet. And why should I care about the things that I say? I was never cool enough to get any real airplay anyway. They wanna walk outside past 9. They wanna play live music and feel alive, but your silence is deafening and their presence is threatening. So say something. Say something. I'm not scared of losing fake friends online, but I'm fucking terrified of sitting back and watching my real friends die. They wanna walk outside past 9. They wanna play live music and feel alive. So smile for the cameras, cause everybody's watching. And Melbourne, you're a big shot, and everybody's laughing. Now everybody knows your name. Everybody knows your name, but your silence is deafening and their presence is threatening. So say something. Say something. Say something. Say something.
Missing you, Melbourne.
Book of Hours is determined to remain an essential platform that offers a creative interpretation for lockdown skeptics and experts who have been censored by mainstream press. Thanks to your donations, we can carry on doing this essential work as working artists. These big issues of the day are vital and need to be heard. So please share our videos, subscribe to our YouTube channel, make a one-time donation on our PayPal page, but most importantly, please be a part of our team on our Patreon page. Go to patreon.com/bookofhours and hit the blue button titled Become a Patron. Thank you.